bring in back, actually, two Apple shareholders that we talked to earlier on Street Smart. Stephen Leeb of Leeb Capital Management and out in Seattle, Michael Borgen of Navellier and Associates. Both, by the way, hold Apple shares in their portfolio. Michael, let me toss it out to you initially. So we've broken down some of those initial numbers from Apple. They beat on both the top and the bottom line. Their forecast looks good. What's your takeaway? You own these shares.
Very, very happy with their beat, but very not surprised at all. This will be the 18th quarter, at least in a row, that Apple has outperformed expectations. Obviously, management at Apple has a very, very long history of offering conservative estimates, but even the most conservative estimates or the most aggressive estimates out there didn't have Apple beating by this much. So we're exceedingly happy with Apple's performance.
Does it bother either of you? Matt and Julie were talking about this in terms of iPods. They were down in terms of the number sold, 19.45 million. That's down 7% in the first quarter. Steve, does it bother you?
No, I think that basically this is iPad, iPhone, Mac Air. This is the core of Apple right now. So iPods, I think, have really been overwhelmed and transcended by all the other products that Apple offers now.
Michael, what do you do when you're looking for a decent estimate, for a decent forecast of what the company's going to do, and Wall Street seems to have failed you for 18 quarters in a row? Where do you get a reliable outlook for what Apple's going to do? Or do you just take the best estimate and add 15%?
That's a great question. Actually, we don't do our own estimating of earnings. What we do is we follow what the analysts are projecting, but we're also following what the earnings surprise is and what happens to the stock after they surprise. And historically, over the last few years, after they surprise Apple, there have only been a couple of instances where Apple's been down after surprising to the upside, and we anticipate that with this beat, Apple will continue to push higher.
Hey, Stephen, in the statement, Peter Oppenheimer, the CFO, says that $9.8 billion in cash flow from operations was generated during the December quarter. Now, to pick up on a theme that we were talking about, Matt, Carol, and I earlier, I mean, how much is the pressure going to increase to return some of that cash to shareholders, maybe to buy back stock, to do a dividend? How important is that?
Well, I think that it's more important they use that cash wisely. There's someone in my office who is predicting Apple, for instance, may buy Netflix. Apple has so much money, I mean $50 billion right now, that they could even consider buying the likes of Amazon. I don't think Jeff Bezos would ever sell it to them. But certainly Netflix is a very, very nice fit for Apple. Me as a shareholder, I would rather see them use that money instead of buying back shares or offering a dividend. I'd rather see them make a real strategic branded acquisition, and I think that's very possible.
All right. Well, also want to add to our roundtable, Brian Marshall. He's an analyst from Gleacher and Company. Brian, by the way, is a Bloomberg best for Apple, which means he's among the most accurate forecasters in the world when it comes to the tech giant. Brian, great to add you into this mix. So you've seen the numbers. What do you think?
Thanks, Carol. Very solid numbers all around. You know, about $2.5 billion of revenue upside compared to our estimate, and very solid results on the bottom line. You know, clearly, I think that the highlight number, I would say, is gross margins going up about 150 basis points sequentially to 38.5%, and a million units of upside on the Mac. Or, I'm sorry, on the iPad. It's 7.3 million units versus our expectations of 6.3. So very solid all around.
I got to ask, Brian, you know, As a reporter who sees this company continually blow away analyst estimates, is there an urge when you're doing the numbers to just add 10 or 20% to whatever you've come up with? Because it must be annoying time and time again to underestimate what the actual result is.
I think that's a fair point, Matt. I mean, if you look at the analysis historically, you know, Apple typically beats revenue anywhere from $1 million to $2 million on average. You know, from a consensus standpoint. So clearly, you know, everybody knows the game that Apple plays. But at the end of the day, we continue to be impressed by their results.
Hey, Brian, it's Julie here. Did some of those gains in iPad unit sales that were better than expected come at the expense of the Mac?
No, actually, Mac's had a record quarter at 4.13 million units versus our expectations of about 4 million units. You know, so I think you know, the new highlight there is the MacBook Airs that are based on flash drives. So, you know, it doesn't seem to be any signs of cannibalization. The iPhone as well was solid at 16.2 million units versus our expectations of 16 million. So it looks pretty solid.
I wonder about, you know, I was talking here with Stephen Leeb, and he was making the point that they still have about 10% market share of personal computers. When does that really start to take off? And do you think that's a goal for the folks at Apple, to really start taking a bigger chunk of market share in the PC market?
Yeah, clearly. You know, Matt, if you look at it, I think, you know, on a blended basis globally, Apple has about 5% of the total handset space, and by our calculations, about 5% of the total PC and notebook space. And so, you know, I think there is a tremendous headroom or runway in front of the company. And so, you know, to get to double digits for both those blended markets, I think that's certainly within the company's goals over the next 3 to 5 years. And, you know, we think that's a possibility as well.
Hey, Brian, it's Dominic here. One of the things that they've also mentioned in this particular release here is the iPhone 4 for Verizon built into to the pipeline, so to speak, for the next quarter here. Looking ahead past this, obviously the future forecast also a bullish kind of, you know, reason for the stock to be getting heading higher possibly when things start trading again. What is the outlook for this iPhone 4 for Verizon, and does that have a huge impact on it going into 2011?
Yeah, I think it's going to be pretty interesting to watch. I mean, clearly, we saw phenomenal things from AT&T over the past couple of years with regards to the iPhone. I think Verizon is going to surprise people to the upside as well. In fact, we estimate roughly 12 million units will be sold to Verizon in calendar year 2011. That's almost 20% of our total current forecast for iPhones in the year, and that's 65 million units. And so, you know, there's a lot of CDMA vendors around, carriers around the world, like KDDI in Japan, for example, China Telecom, some carriers in South Korea. So it's not only Verizon, this is a pretty global market opportunity as well.
Brian, I want you to get your thoughts on this. We've talked about this with Steve and Michael already about Steve Jobs' health. I mean, there's been a lot of news about Apple over the last couple of days, of course, earnings, and then questions about the outlook for Mr. Jobs. We certainly wish him well. You write in your note here that Apple remains the best technology company on the planet with numerous catalysts on the horizon. How do you feel about the horizon for this company looking 3 to 5 years out, or is it hard to tell at this point?
I think it's pretty positive. I mean, clearly they're on sort of a three-year product cycle. We had the volume ramp of the iPod in 2004. We had the iPhone in 2007. We had the iPad in 2010. 2013, I think it's going to be something to do with the living room. So clearly, you know, they've got the next couple of years all set up. If Steve should unfortunately not be able to return to the company, you know, I would think that would start to impair Apple from a strategic, innovative standpoint within, you know, 5 to 10 years down the road, so longer term. I think in the near term and the intermediate term, the company is very well positioned.
All right. Thanks very much, Brian. Brian Marshall there from Gleacher talking about Apple. Let me ask you, are you concerned that with Steve Jobs' absence, we won't see any new products coming out? Because there's certainly is room for more products to come from Apple. But in the past, when Tim Cook has taken over for Jobs on medical leave, they haven't developed anything new. They just sort of executed with what they've got.
Right. I think they're in a wonderful position to execute right now. I really think over the next 2 to 3 years, Apple is going to, they've got nothing but tailwinds. And another tailwind that people really don't mention is this whole issue of cybersecurity. I mean, you know, basically it was the Israelis and the Americans who threw off the Iranian nuclear program by maybe 2 or 3 years. Cybersecurity, Defense Department, et cetera. I mean, anybody that has I always say IBM computer, but I mean, you know, a Windows computer knows how vulnerable they are to...
It's no longer an IBM computer.
I know. I'm dating myself big time, really big time. But anyone that has a Windows, Microsoft, whatever computer, they know how vulnerable their computer is to viruses. I mean, my computer never runs well. It really doesn't. I mean, I'm lucky that it runs. But with Apple, no such issues. Cybersecurity, a major, major tailwind.
Right. Michael Borgen, I don't want to leave you out there. In terms of the future, do you want to see Apple kind of getting some more idea men into the fold? We talked about their bench earlier. We've all agreed it's a good bench. But do we want to see some idea men, people that are other or women?
Idea women.
I mean that with everybody. Visionaries, do you want to see that added to the company? Is that what we need to see? And we should point out the stock, Apple stock up about 4.5% here in the aftermarket.
That's a great question. And undoubtedly, Apple will definitely need to have either a singular visionary or a group of visionaries help lead Apple further down the road. Like I mentioned before, we think they're fine in the short term. We definitely think they're fine in the intermediate term. But longer term, they're definitely going to have somebody come or some people come to the forefront and offer up some more strategic ideas. But we are still happy that Steve mm-hmm. Jobs is going to be available
right.
for those strategic discussions.
We certainly wish him well. Gentlemen, thank you so much. Steve Leeb of Leeb Capital and also Michael Borgen of Navellier & Associates talking to us before the earnings report and talking to us after. We really appreciate it.